So I'm going to talk about heart disease in general, and I'm going to kind of compare and contrast insulin resistance as a driver of cardiac dysfunction versus the bad cholesterol, okay, which we've talked about mostly for 50 years. I give a call out to Gabor Ardosi from Hungary, who I've collaborated with for many months, and he has given me new insights into the importance of adipose tissue and the insulin resistance cascade. So I'll show you a bit of that. Might be a little heavy, but we'll see. Okay, where's the index? The sponsorship Doug mentioned there, it's David Bobbitt. He's one of Ireland's most successful entrepreneurs, and he runs one of Ireland's biggest corporations and owns it. And he had a near-death experience with cardiovascular disease. He discovered it through the calcium scan, and he changed his whole life around, and now he wants to let everyone know about it. So he's helping myself and Dr. Gerber with a book that'll come out maybe at the end of the year, and we have no financial ties to the heart imaging industry. This is purely philanthropic. So, as Doug mentioned, and I'll admit, another disclosure, I'm an engineer, and it's known as the problem-solving profession. I just picked this up this morning, I was thinking of grounding. But a brief history of myself, so I've worked in medical device industry and in high volume manufacture. My main specialty is to lead teams in complex problem solving, you know, in major industrial engineering issues, which can be quite complex and multifactorial. And heart disease is certainly one like that. I'll just index. In 2013, as a brief background, I had some personal health issues where I got a couple of blood tests. Actually, serum ferritin was very high, as Dr. McCullough referred to, and my gamma glutamyl transferase, a liver enzyme. And I was quite worried because when I did an initial lookup, I could see the hazard ratios for these things, and they're pretty shocking. But I went to three doctors in succession, and it was quite clear to me from my professional experience that they didn't really understand the root cause or how to resolve them. So I went and researched them myself for a few weeks through PubMed and ResearchGate and the literature. And in a few weeks I had it fixed. And I also dropped 35 pounds and I got all my bloods in a great place. So it really changed my life in a way because I have five children and I don't want to carry unnecessary risk. So I began to give seminars to engineers in work and large crowds and put them on YouTube, and then I got more involved. Okay, so why you'd be interested in this is around a third of you generally in this room will have a heart attack by the time you're in your early 70s. Perhaps not this room because you're kind of low-carb guys, but on average. And there are some very simple measurements that are not used commonly which could predict with quite great accuracy who's likely to go down, right? We'll talk a bit about those. The content is, I'll go through cholesterol at a high level, beyond cholesterol to primary causes of cardiovascular disease, to the ultimate test, which is calcification, and then we'll finish up with a critique of cholesterol as cause. Part one, the cholesterol conundrum, and this is the quick version. My YouTube version is 1 hour and 10 minutes for this alone. But I'll do a simple version. So where does your cholesterol come from? Well, it mostly comes from your liver and your body cells. 80% of your cholesterol is made by you because it's a crucial molecule. With no cholesterol, no life. And around 20% comes from your diet. So if you eat less cholesterol, your body will make more. If you eat more cholesterol, your body will make less. So America, finally, with the rest of the Western world, has dropped cholesterol dietary guidelines because they realize it's kind of meaningless for most people. The cholesterol is hydrophobic, so it can't really travel in your hydrophilic or water-based blood system. So the cholesterol needs to be packaged in kind of boats or submarines, and it's guarded safe inside. And this one is VLDL, it's the one your liver makes to transmit cholesterol around your system. And cholesterol goes in there, but also triglyceride. Now, triglyceride is just a storage form of fat. It's a glycerol molecule with three fatty acids. And it also is fat-based, so it has to travel in the boats. And that's all good. Great system. When the boats travel around your body, they actually dock with muscle. And the boat hull opens, and you transfer triglyceride to be burnt as healthy fat energy in your muscles. Skeletal muscle, heart muscle, all over. It's probably worth pointing out, though, when your triglyceride blood level is high, and that's a risk factor and that's a bad thing, it won't really be the fat you eat that makes that high, because excessive carbohydrate is the best route to getting a high blood triglyceride. So just note that. But when the triglyceride goes into the muscle, you're all good to go, and it'll get burnt. Now, if you're sitting on your ass watching X Factor and having a Coke, right, you're not going to burn all that stuff, and you will store it in fat for a rainy day. Or if you keep doing that, the rainy day might come sooner. So, after the VLDL has been drained of triglyceride, it naturally loses a couple of signaling proteins and it becomes an LDL. And now we see the bad cholesterol, right? The LDL. Woo. But I have it as green because evolution has spent millions of years creating this exquisite system and there is nothing bad about cholesterol. Yet. However, and oh, one more note, I'll just mention the good cholesterol, HDL, and this basically has a lot of control functions. It protects the LDL bolts from being oxidized. It transfers cholesterol and triglyceride in and out of the LDL class, and it basically master manages the system. So it is the good cholesterol, and you don't want to be low on that. The LDL bolts, after around 2 days in a healthy person, get taken up at the liver receptor system. And they get broken up, recycled, nature doesn't waste, the cholesterol gets used again, and the triglyceride. All good. But what if you do something wrong in your environment? And the most important thing in your environment is nutritional, what you put in your mouth. If you do something wrong, you can knock this system out of kilter. And then maybe you will have a cholesterol problem. However, we'd be interested as engineers in the root causes of what drives the system into dysfunction. Not too worried about the mechanisms of the cholesterol now. We're worried about root causes. They're the things you got to address. So we'll put aside those cholesterol mechanisms, and we'll see that the root causes, if they are going on in your body, will drive this risk factor bingo. All of these things that we know that are bad when they're high, good when they're low, you'll see your trigs go up, HDL go down, and it depends on your genetic profile what this will look like. But these are all bad things. You'll notice here that the LDL particle count will tend to go up, the ApoB or LDLP, driven by this problem, and your oxidized LDL will tend to go up, and we'll come back to those later. But all in all, the root causes drive atherosclerosis, which is the inflammatory disease of your arterial wall, where material and lipids are building up in the wall, macrophage and immune components are recruited, and they attack, and eventually maybe a scab can burst, an atheroma, and block the blood flow and oxygen flow to your heart. And that's where most MIs or heart attacks come from. So you want to avoid that. You want to focus on the root causes. You want to fix the root causes, right? That's what we do in my other life. So part two, beyond cholesterol, right? Let's move on to some more serious stuff, right? And get away from the humorous aspects. So we'll bring in a leading edge expert, and some of you may be familiar with Dr. Thomas Dayspring. He's top of his field, given thousands of lectures, and he's a lipidologist, so he's a cholesterol guy, primarily, okay? And I badgered him a little a couple of years ago based on some analysis I did around LDL, the bad cholesterol, and MIs, and he clarified a couple of really useful things. He said that in reality, most heart attacks are due to, connected with, or related to insulin resistance. That's good to know. I used to think it was cholesterol, right? And he also said that LDL cholesterol that we've looked at for 30 years is a near useless indicator of cardiovascular disease risk. And he's a cholesterol guy, remember. He's not in my side of the house. But that was good. So what is this insulin resistance thing? If it's the primary driver, and even cholesterol people acknowledge that, and a growing number of professionals around the world, let's have a look at it. So the way I view it is, if this is LDL as a causal driver of coronary vascular disease, this little mouse here, well, then this is insulin resistance, right? This is the elephant in the room. And it's finally, in the recent years, getting addressed. So I'll go through insulin resistance, and something I've become more aware of in recent months is that the adipose tissue there's a lot of evidence that it falls first when you begin to become insulin resistant, and that it's really, really important. So I'll show here a few different types of people. You've got metabolically healthy normal weight, slimish people whose adipose tissue, subcutaneous fat, is working well, and it is the buffer, really, between your food and your liver. If your adipose is working very functionally, it will take in the food and it will release it beautifully later when you're fasting. And this person's healthy, they're insulin sensitive, and they'll have a low risk level for chronic disease. We look at a rather different person here, still slim, metabolically obese, normal weight. Now this guy here hasn't been able to expand his adipose tissue to keep up with the problem foods he's eating. And he's generated visceral adipose tissue in around his organs, which is like the second shield to take the pain, right? But he's got inflammation and he's not in a good place, and some of the bullets are getting through. And the liver and the systemic insulin resistance is being affected. And he has a high insulin resistance, and his risk level, from all the data in the literature, is high. Okay? We've got metabolically unhealthy obese, which is the classic person who is very overweight. He's created a load more subcutaneous and a lot more visceral adipose tissue, but he's passed his threshold and it still ain't good enough. It's inflamed and not working properly, and he's taken a fusillade of bullets, right? And then finally, we've got the metabolically healthy obese, really interesting guys. And these guys have expanded their subcutaneous adipose tissue and their visceral tissue, but it's in relatively good shape. And because of genetics and because of what they're eating, they've managed to become healthy, very overweight, okay? And they are still protecting their system. Now, really nice study here. I hope you enjoy it. I did. They looked at very heavy guys, 45 BMI, all of them. Now, that's pretty heavy, right? And they're all around 45 years old, so, you know, they're not old guys. And they split out the guys who are insulin-sensitive obese. And you can see from their metrics there, their glucose infusion rate is high. It's really good. Their fasting insulin is nice. It's around the same as mine. Their A1Cs are okay, and their trig over HDL, which is a great measure from the cholesterol panel, in fact, is one of the only useful ones, that's pretty good. I just put in the LDL there as a joke, because that's what it kind of is. But we look at the insulin-resistant obese. Now, they're in a very different place. They have a crap glucose infusion rate in the insulin clamp test, and the rest of their metrics, as you can see, are really bad. And these guys are carrying all the risk, because it goes with the insulin resistance, not with the weight, okay? I think a lot of people are aware of that now. Let's look a little closer at them, and the guy on the left here is the insulin sensitive, and he has a particular look, a lot of subcutaneous folds on the outside of the muscle wall, okay? And the guy on the right is the insulin resistant, and he's got a different appearance. He has more visceral tissue inside the muscle wall. He's in a different place. And if you look at these micrographs, they're both to 100 micron scale. They're both the same scale. But look at the size of the fat tissue cells in the insulin-sensitive guy. They're small, they're not hypertrophic, they're in good shape. And these cells, fat cells in the insulin-resistant guy, are not only greatly enlarged and he's got hypertrophy, right? But all that dark you see in there is macrophage. It's immune system components. So he's attacking his own fat. Once the cells get big enough, he's in a bad place, and his metrics reflect it. Now they all, the concept I would have is there's safe fat that shields you, and there's sick fat, and there's quite a clear difference. They put the data in this nice form. The insulin-sensitive obese, 45 BMI, have the same glucose infusion rate or sensitivity as people of 25 BMI from the population. So they're essentially still healthy. Now, not for long probably, but they are now. And you can see the insulin-resistant heavy guys, same weight, but their glucose infusion is in the toilet, right? So that's important. Interestingly, in this paper they realized, and these are recent papers where a lot of this is coming out, they realized that if they just measured their adiponectin, which is an important hormone that your fat cells make, and it's insulin sensitizing to your system and your muscles, if they just looked at the level of adiponectin in these guys and the amount of macrophage in their fat tissue, those two metrics of all of them could predict almost 100% exactly what their insulin sensitivity is. And you don't often get that in engineering or medicine, that accurate a correlation. So it shows the importance of those components in the adipose. And I'm actually, for time, probably going to skip this. It just shows the insulin resistance have more visceral adipose tissue, and it also tracks with their sensitivity. And the insulin sensitive have all the same amount, and it's relatively non-inflamed and safe. So I'll bring you through the pictorial view. I kind of make up these little diagrams. So you've got a pancreas, you've got the adipose tissue we talked about, you've got the liver, which is the center of everything in many ways, and muscular tissue. Your pancreas produces insulin, and it's a master controller. It's a master signaling hormone that controls much more than just the take-up of glucose into the cells. It even back controls into the pancreas itself and suppresses glucagon to control gluconeogenesis in the liver and other things. So it's really an exquisite system. And this guy here shown has low levels of insulin, and he's a healthy guy. So let's see what you could do with that. The adipose tissue, and I won't get into the detailed mechanisms, is more and more being understood that when it's healthy, it releases lipokines, signaling fat molecules that actually crosstalk to the liver and maintain your system sensitivity. So the fat's a really important signaling organ. Now, if you eat carbohydrates, I'm sure you don't eat too much of them, but if you do, they're just glucose, and there's no point being under any illusions here. Carbohydrates, bread, pasta, and rice, it's just glucose, it's just sugar. There's some nutrients in there, but you know, there's a lot better nutrient-dense foods, right? So it's just sugar, glucose. And when you eat too much of that, we won't say yet what too much is, it'll depend on the person, what happens? Well, you'll release more insulin, because insulin will be required to control your blood glucose and many other things. So you're going to get a little bit more hyperinsulinemic, postprandial and in general with time. Okay? And that I would see as the first punch to your system. It's not going to knock you out, not going to kill you. Some people get away with high carb for a long time. Okay? But in general, and for lots of people, you will tend towards insulin resistance in the adipose tissue and a slight loss of sensitivity if you push this hard. And then you lose out on some of these systemic signalers that help the liver manage the overall system. And there's even a new one, asprosin, which is literally just discovered. It was quite fascinating. I only got it 2 weeks ago. And it's a nanomole level, very low level kind of activator. And when they turn up and down asprosin, they can turn up and down systemic insulin resistance, right, in mice, just by turning that asprosin. So I think in the coming years, we'll see more and more that the adipose tissue is really, really important, and there'll be more discoveries. Okay, so you've taken a lot of carbohydrates, you've punched yourself a bit. What if you ate fructose, right? Quite a bit of fructose. Now, fructose is a sugar molecule. It's half of table sugar, soft drinks, honey, what we think of as sugar. Half of that is fructose, half is glucose. Okay, so we talked about glucose, but what if you eat too much fructose? Now, fructose has to go to the liver for processing. It's completely different than glucose. If you're eating very little and you're eating a lot of fructose, it can convert to glucose and be used relatively safely. But if you're eating a lot of glucose and you're adding in a lot of fructose, it's like alcohol, it has to go to the liver, and it has a tendency to drive systemic insulin resistance. Okay? There's quite a lot of data around that. So, I would say that's the second punch you give your system, and you'll jack up your hyperinsulinemia a little more over the years, okay? Now, there's lots of other things that drive this problem of insulin resistance, and I won't read through them all. You might do some of them, you might do a lot of them. But either way, if you're doing these things, and there are mechanisms for all of them, well, that's a kick in the ass to your system on top of the punches, okay? So it's kind of multifactorial here. And if you keep pushing that, more or less of this, you will become more muscular insulin resistance also, as well as the liver and the other organs. And over time, your problem will build. And The way this works is like in engineering complex systems, control systems, there's an element of self-reinforcing or a vicious cycle. The more you become hyperinsulinemic, that affects your insulin sensitivity and lowers it. The more insulin resistant you get, the more you got to rack up your hyperinsulinemia to let it do its job and manage energy flux. So do you see the kind of self-reinforcing cycle here? You keep the punches coming in, and this will build and build, and it will bring you to a nasty destination. The adipose tissue will eventually get quite inflamed. That is a serious problem. And this person still has their blood glucose under control because the hyperinsulinemia is keeping it down. So all the docs are looking at the fasting glucose and thinking he's okay or she's okay. They're not. Their control system's gone to hell, right? So what is the end game? When does it end and you get your diagnosis? Well, what actually happens is eventually the pancreas, which has had outrageous demands for insulin for many years, eventually tells you to piss off. And rightly so. I don't blame that little pancreas at all. It's abusive what's been done. And the flow of insulin begins to flag. Now, when the flow of insulin begins to flag in a system that requires gallons of it, right, you will lose brakes. You will get brake failure. And the hyperinsulinemia that was stopping lipolysis of triglyceride in the fat cells and holding that from happening and releasing free fatty acids from your fat, that's going to break. And when that breaks, you're going to get a flood of free fatty acids and glycerol to your liver. And now you're going to have a phenomenon where substrate push, not signaling anymore, but pure bulk substrate will create processes in the liver to run faster and faster and to drive gluconeogenesis, even when you're not eating. And that's when your blood glucose finally goes out of control and you get your diagnosis 20 years after you could have got it from simple blood test measurements. And I think this is the tragedy in the last decades. And then it's game over. And if you remember your 80s game, it's not a coin you're putting in. You got to horse in exogenous insulin to keep the game going, but you're heading straight for MIs. Most type 2 diabetics die of heart attacks. And then you got the retinopathy, you got the neuropathy, you got the feet being taken off. This is a big deal. Biggest disease in the world, really. So why couldn't you measure it decades before and be able to tell someone, you're going there, and here's where you are on your journey. You know, you're early, but you're going there. And then a few year or two later, you go back to your doc and he says, well, now you're actually around here on your journey. That's what people should be told, but they're not. So measuring it part one, we'll go to Professor Reeven in the 80s, did some very good work. And he coined the term metabolic syndrome. And he figured out from all the data, well, you know, if you have three or more of these things above a certain level, you got metabolic syndrome. You're a special guy. But there's no special prizes. Because what you get is a much higher degree of risk for atherosclerosis and coronary disease. Now, what they didn't really realize at the time is metabolic syndrome jacks up your risk for all of these modern inflammatory diseases. Right? So if you Google metabolic syndrome and the disease of your choice, you're going to get a lot of hits and you're going to have a lot of papers to read. And I've read probably 1,000 of them at this stage. So didn't I say earlier insulin resistance was kind of the big thing, the big elephant in the room? So how come there's another big monster, right? This is kind of a bit silly. Well, it's not so silly because metabolic syndrome is now more properly called insulin resistance syndrome. There's only one big elephant, and it's stomping over increasing numbers in the modern world. So, how could you maybe not have to measure all these different things? Have I got 3, 4? Am I screwed? Or what's going on? Well, you could measure your insulin secretion rate, particularly after a meal, and that would tell you most of what all the other ones would tell you, right? Because that's the master measure. And we have a saying in engineering, if you don't measure it, it don't get fixed. And I live by this one. It is crucial to measure the correct and most predictive and most accurate measurements. But not many people are measuring insulin, certainly postprandial insulin. They're measuring cholesterol. Okay, so measuring it part two, and here we're going to look at a really important guy, master measures. Dr. Joseph R. Kraft, who started his career as a medical captain in World War II, stationed in Panama. And we met him last year, and he's still going fairly strong, right? Think of that. He wrote a book, Diabetes Epidemic and You, and everyone should read this book. Around 6-7 years ago, I read it, I nearly dropped out of my chair. He has tables of data from 15,000 patients where he did an extensive insulin characterization test. So, myself and Dr. Gerber had to interview him in the Trump Tower, Chicago. And here's Joe, lovely man, cogent, really nice, incredibly brilliant, and at 95 gave us a great interview, and it's on the web if you want to Google it. He had a diabetes in situ test because he was a pathologist and a doctor of nuclear medicine and radio labeling, and he was a really, really accomplished guy. But he began to test patients, eventually over 14,000, and he would give them glucose, like a glucose tolerance test, right? But importantly, he had measured their insulin response over time, at 0, 1/2 hour, 1 hour, all the way up to 5 hours. You know, he's a real focused guy. And he noticed that there was patterns that emerged. In the first 1,000 patients he did, he realized there were different patterns, quite distinct. And he saw this pattern in some, only around 20%. And this was pattern one, euinsulinemia, healthy, non-diabetic, right? But only around 25% of the guys got that. And there were mixed patients, potential diabetics, walk-in patients, random, okay? And he saw that most of them were type 2, 3, or 4, hyperinsulinemia, diabetes in situ. And this meant from his pathology and research to him that they were essentially diabetic. So the diabetic iceberg is huge, much bigger than what you see from glucose, because all of these failures, 90% passed a fasting glucose, and 50-odd percent even passed an OGTT, a glucose tolerance. So he called this, correctly, the earliest laboratory diagnosis for diabetes, and it should be used to warn people early, right? I'll show you a very recent study, I think out of China, 2013. They did essentially craft type patterns, and 11 years later, they checked back with the guys. These were all non-diabetics, supposedly, and they followed the cohort. The pattern one guys, early in the study, ended up having 3% full-blown diabetes. Pretty damn good for the modern figures. The pattern 2 and 3 then were heading up 5x that rate of diabetes. Look at these guys. You've got a test that you can predict a cohort that half of them will be full-blown diabetics versus a cohort where only a couple of percent will be. That's an enormous test. Diabetes should never be a surprise. Never. And did you know that a report in 2015 said that over half of adult Americans are pre-diabetic or diabetic, which to an engineer is the same thing, essentially. It's a spectrum. Hyperinsulinemic, insulin resistant, pre-diabetic, diabetic. Actually, splitting them up confuses the issue. And that's something that really annoys me as well. And if you did a CRAF test, I'm guessing, and Dr. Gerber would agree, and Ted Naiman and a few others, that probably 2/3 of them are essentially diabetic. And diabetes is the biggest driver of heart disease by a mile, right? And 2/3 of the people essentially have it. So, go figure. So, Joseph Kraft said many years ago, those with cardiovascular disease not identified with diabetes are simply undiagnosed. That's a powerful statement. And I think he meant the vast majority of cardiovascular disease relates to this vascular dysfunction of diabetes. So, very recent study, I'm showing you all the new stuff. This is a European one, 2015. They took 4,004 cardiovascular patients from ages 18 to 80. Imagine, a group of all ages, 24 countries, perfect randomized group of heart disease patients. And they removed all diabetics first, because they knew diabetes drives heart disease like crazy. So they removed all the diabetics and looked at these 4,000. And they found out pretty quickly, a third of them nearly were full diabetics. I mean, you couldn't make this stuff up. And they found out that in total, 2/3 of them were high risk for diabetes, which is diabetic. 2/3 of them were effectively diabetic. After removing all the diabetics first, 2/3 of the heart disease victims are diabetic. I mean, it's hilarious. And I think the remaining 34%, I'd put a lot of money that not many of them would pass a CRAF test, right? So you can probably see the scale of potential issue here. So we'll go to the root cause diagram now for cardiovascular disease, and we like to use these diagrams. You got your liver, you got your hyperinsulinemia and insulin resistance, which are, Kraft said, they are not combatants, they are one and the same, they are sides of a coin. Each drives each other. You've got the fatty liver and ectopic fat that goes with this situation. That drives hyperinsulin, right? High blood insulin, that has many mechanistic pathways to get lipids into the vascular wall and to drive atherosclerosis. You've got higher blood glucose, particularly postprandial in this state, right? And that also has many mechanistic pathways to drive atherosclerosis. Higher blood pressure. Now, blood pressure being high causes shear stress and strain in the arteries and drives atherosclerosis as an accelerator. But guess what? It's emerging more and more now that idiopathic blood pressure, or blood pressure with no known cause, is likely mostly hyperinsulinemia. See? You put this together, right? You've got your visceral fat tissue, which releases cytokines and inflammatory molecules and systemic signalers, and it also becomes more resistant as the system becomes resistant. So you've got a double arrow there. And all of this stuff drives atherogenic dyslipidemia. The risk factor bingo they've been playing with for 40 years. All the familiar faces are there. And yes, it will drive higher LDL counts. So higher LDL particle counts, or ApoB, are a great reflector of insulin resistance. In fact, that's what I think they're most useful for, to be quite honest. And this mess in its entirety is very likely the primary driver or dominant driver of cardiovascular disease. How would you tackle this massive problem? What would you do? Well, I'd say excess fructose and excess carb are something you'd want to get down. You might be able to take quite a bit of carb, depending on your profile. Without fructose, you might be able to take quite a bit of fructose if you're not eating a whole lot of carb. But I think there's a synergy, so I put an and there. You've got to dodge that. Low omega-3 or high omega-6, or particularly both together, there is a lot of data around that ratio of 3 to 6 being intimately linked, especially to sudden cardiac death. You've got sun exposure, vitamin D. I agree with Dr. Mercola on that one. It's huge, and I'd rather get it from the sun than from pills for certain reasons. We've got certain vitamins and minerals. Magnesium, I think, is a huge one. Probably 80% of people are magnesium deficient, and it partakes in tons of reactions in the body, a lot of them relating to this. And genetic tendency you can't avoid. Some people are very exposed to poor diets. We got lack of sleep, lack of exercise, disturb the hormonal system and will drive insulin resistance. They did a study with US Marines where they deprived them of sleep for just a couple of weeks, and their insulin sensitivity was halved in that period with no other intervention. Just lack of sleep, okay? And we've got pollutants, and smoking obviously drives your insulin up and drives everything crazy. There are other causes of cardiovascular disease, heavy metal contamination. It's not all insulin resistance by any means. And the thing I like about these things, which I do for myself, is they also have mechanistic pathways to atherosclerosis and heart disease beyond the insulin resistance, with ages, rages, and oxidative stress that can be driven. Okay, it's metabolic mayhem, and it's the primary problem, I would say. So part three, the power of the CAC score, and I'll try and speed through this, but just give you an idea. The calcification test, these are the pioneers who realized its enormous power back in the 70s, and they had difficulty getting it adopted, and to this day it's not adopted enough. There's a movie, The Widowmaker, which my sponsor funded to get made about this whole story. It's fascinating, and I recommend you have a look. So on the left here, and I believe Jeff earlier may have shown this, you've got someone with no score, zero, which is a warranty. They're talking about that as a 15-year warranty for a middle-aged person. If you get a zero for all cause in cardiovascular, your chances of dying are so low, it's like a warranty. Guy on the right, probably 600 or 700. No warranty for that guy. Vastly higher risk, okay? And yeah, it is Jeff. He's looking pretty good for 54. What do you reckon? Yeah. So I got a zero at 47 last year, so happy with that. So what about the studies on CAC? Well, let's look at Framingham. You've heard of the Framingham risk factor. That's used all over the world, right, to judge your risk. To me, it's a bit of a joke. It's so noisy for risk estimation. I'm not sure what I would do with it at all. But let's say you took the 10% riskers who are medium risk, right? Let's say you gave them a scan. Well, if these 10% guys got a scan and got a low score, they'd have a really low risk, relatively. And it would be much more accurate than Framingham. If they got a higher score, they'd have a serious risk. And if they got a very high score, they'd have major issues to deal with. But all of these guys would think they were in the fuzzy 10% if they didn't get a score. So that's how powerful it is. You can really change your life when you see things like this. Framingham takes a guess. Calcium sees the disease, the calcium in the arteries that's recruited to shore up your arteries when there's plaque present. That's why it's so powerful a predictor. It sees the disease, it's not a risk factor. I won't labor on this, but there are so many studies and they all say the same thing. 10x risk for having a high score versus a low, sometimes even 20x. And you can re-categorize middle risk people by giving them a scan and you can put over half of them into low or high risk just by getting a scan. Otherwise, they're in middle risk. They don't know what's going on, right? I'll skip through that for speed. Here's one Jeff pulled out, 2015, the cardiovascular imaging journal. You can see there, very low score, 1%, very high, 37%. 37x? High cholesterol is like 1.2x risk or something, you know? It's a joke. Here's one I got recently. It shows going into the page a higher score, and you can see the massive risk increase with a higher score for all-cause mortality. The graphs are the same for cardiovascular and other diseases. But you can see going left to right, whether you have one, two, three, or more risk factors, there's only a slight increase in risk. Calcification blows away the risk factors. It's an engineering test. What about score progression? And really quickly here, they got high scoring people and your high score reflects your disease to date. Technically, if you suddenly get healthy, your score will stop progressing. But they got high scoring people and they followed them over time in this study. And basically the stats were done on the survival curves and the really high scorers that were indexing or increasing every year rapidly had an enormous exposure to heart events. And equivalent people who had a high score at the start, but they did not increase per year, had that event rate. And generally, there's a 6x or 7x difference if you're increasing per year versus not increasing. So if you have a high score, like my sponsor, you do all the right stuff, because he understands all of what I'm telling you, you stop your score. When you stop your score, your risk level drops down nearly to you never had a score. So it's not all hopeless by any means. And this kind of tells you the bottom line, right? It's obligatory for many years for US presidents and all astronauts must have it. And there's a reason, because the best goddamn test there is. And important people need to have it. Maybe we're not important, but I got one. Okay, final part four, cholesterol capers. Hyperinsulinemia as driver versus cholesterol as cause. Let's look at some risk stuff. The classic LDL-C bad cholesterol, right? For 20 or 30 years, doctors, everyone around the world has been told it's the big one. Let's take a look at it. An honest look. Here's a trial done, Helsinki policemen, and it was a really good trial where they took a large cohort of middle-aged men and they got their insulin sensitivity with a very accurate test at the start, right? Steady state plasma glucose, not just a fasting insulin, that's noisy. And they split them into quintiles. And what they found at the 6-year point in the study is the lowest insulin resistance people, there was one event, around 1%. What about the highest fifth of people? It was 9. That's a big multiplier, right? It's quite a good study. Now, I won't get into the detail too much, I'll show you in a minute, but again, bad cholesterol being higher, it's a much smaller multiplier of risk. And in fact, when you approach your heart event, and you're actually approaching your heart attack, bad cholesterol tends to be lower than the average person. So it's bad when it's high early on, it's bad when it's low later. So to be honest, engineers would never use it. hyperinsulinemia, I would say, is the elephant. Here's a group of studies where I tried to find studies that had insulin metrics and outcomes, right, health outcomes, and also bad cholesterol or cholesterol in them. And I found this bunch of them. And guess what? Insulin, proinsulin, C-peptide and glucose, and all of these metrics of insulin signaling were highly predictive of outcomes, very significant. And all the bad cholesterol didn't even show up. They nearly pushed it to the bottom of the report. It's a bit embarrassing, right? And in some of them, as I mentioned, it was inverse. The lower cholesterol people were the people with the events. It's pretty shocking. Reeven did this study, 2002, and he basically, in the study, he told people, look, insulin resistance is probably the primary driver of most modern chronic disease and age-related disease. Wake up, guys. But no one's probably read it, but I'll show it to you. He got a bunch of middle-aged people, around three groups of 70. He categorized them by low insulin in a very good insulin resistance test, medium and high. 6.5 years later, the low insulin people, no disease, no death, happy retirees. The medium insulin people, cardiovascular disease, cancer, hypertension, and diabetes, the usual set. And two deaths. And the high insulin people, 24 out of the 70, a third of them with disease. And four deaths. Smallish numbers, but it's highly statistically significant. He doesn't mention LDL, because he knows 20 years ago, he knows the problems, it's a bit of a farce. Okay, elephant again. I'll remind you very briefly of the calcium score. It is the ultimate predictor and sees arterial disease. So given that it's the ultimate measure, any risk factor you're gonna tell me about had better correlate with the real level of disease in the arteries. It has to. Not so. This 2009 paper, they're basically saying LDL doesn't show up at all. Everyone's going to revisit this. In all the studies where they have calcium scanning results and LDL levels and events, heart attacks, rate, LDL never relates to the arterial disease. Even with familial hypercholesterolemics, who are the poster child for LDL, right? We've heard for decades. Within those in studies, the high LDL hypercholesterolemiacs versus the low, there is no correlation with the degree of arterial disease they have, even within FH. So this for me is the final punch. I mean, that ends LDL-C. It ends it, it's over. Engineers would move on now and just say, what the hell were we doing for 20 years? So ApoB, the new bad cholesterol, because I think they know the LDL-C is kind of falling and getting flushed down the toilet. Not many of them, but the next few years it'll come out. So ApoB is the LDL particle count. This is the new LDL, right? So let's have a look at that. I showed you the root cause diagram, and I stressed that the metabolic mayhem drives up the LDL particle count, and that will give it a lot of its risk association, because it reflects insulin resistance, which is high risk. But I'm having difficulty. Recent papers show ApoB being high might have even up to a 15 or 17x hazard ratio or odds ratio of being resistant. So ApoB and insulin resistance and many other inflammatory issues are intimately linked. So how do you say, or can you say, that ApoB on its own, when everything else is good, independently burrows into the endothelium and detonates on its own? Healthy LDLP particles cause damage on their own with no other systemic problem. I've been looking for the data for a few years, still haven't got it. And that's kind of the new cholesterol theory. It's a great marker, and if it's high, you got to go and look at things. But independently pathogenic, I've been waiting. Okay, the last one. How many people here know about LP little a? Ah, yeah, not too many. It's the sexy bad cholesterol, right? It's the next generation. So the people who specialize in this love it. However, I did a bit of research on it because I had some suspicions. Why is LP little a, this new one, not a risk factor in the highest level when you have low oxidized LDL or low LPPLA2, right? Up here, it's no longer a risk factor being high. And that worries me. That tells me it's an interacting variable, not a root cause. Why in this study, if your LDL cholesterol is below 160, is the top quintile of Lp(a) not a risk factor anymore, just by being below 160? Why in this study, here's the pink bar, if your Framingham risk score, which indicates inflammation and underlying problems, if that score is 10%, Lp(a) is not a risk factor. It's only a risk factor if you have other stuff going on. And in this study, if your HDL is above 55, Lp(a) falls away in significance as a risk factor. So I'd ask the question, why is Lpa only an issue for people with existing inflammatory issues? And therefore, I would work on the issue and not the interacting variable. Okay. So I'm wrapping it up now, and I don't know what my time is. 2 minutes. I live by the Pareto principle. 20% of the stuff you can work on will give you 80% of the results, right? So what would I work on? Because you can't work on everything if I wanted to stay alive long or help other people. Well, I drew this little diagram, and it's the tree of modern chronic disease, right? It's kind of some pretty ugly fruit there, yeah? And I believe the taproot feeding this tree is insulin and leptin signaling and dysregulation. It is not as simple as just lower your carb. There are many, many feeder routes that drive insulin resistance, and you've got to tackle them all. Some different people will have different problems, and I won't read them all out. And there are other causes of chronic disease. It's not all insulin resistance. It just happens to be the elephant, right? And then we have cholesterol, which actually only acts on cardiovascular disease, so it's already a smaller thing by definition. But my worry is, it's intimately connected into the big cause in many, many ways. So how independent is it? How small is it really? And I wonder over the years, because we've only heard about cholesterol, that that root, if it is a big root, might have been inappropriately or excessively nourished over the past few decades. But who am I to say? Thank you. Okay. Do I stay up here?
I had a question about the fasting insulin test with carbohydrate. I ordered one for myself, and I just wanted to also tell you this little anecdote. It's kind of crazy. My sister's been having high fasting sugars, very healthy, fit. So I had to ask her doctor for this. Of course, he only orders the glucose tolerance without the insulin, and he gives her the results, and she had a blood sugar of 110 after, or 140 after 75 grams, and 30 minutes later, an hour later, the blood sugar was 70. And he writes her a note, says, "You're normal, nothing's wrong."
That's quite low, maybe.
Right. Jeff, so I just think it's interesting because, you know, obviously we would see a dysregulation with her insulin metabolism. Because I've been having her test the blood sugars at home, and she's never fallen below 110. So anyways, I think that was interesting.
And what are her insulin? Oh, you don't have any insulin.
No, so I made her go back to her doctor and I'll read. Yeah, that's not the test they told you to get, but anyways. So I'm going to give you fasting insulin with the glucose. And one of the things they tell you is make sure you eat 150 grams of carbohydrate for 3 days prior to getting the test. I want to do this right. I'm not at 150 grams of carbs a day right now. Do I need to do that in order to get an accurate test?
Yeah, so Kraft actually did 2 weeks because he was a scientist and he wanted perfect results. So if you do that, you will get a better result that's more reflective. And if you're healthy, you'll get a pattern one. But if you don't do it, you may get a pattern five, which is hypoinsulin. You get really low insulin response if you don't do that. And then you are either healthy, but you didn't eat your carb enough, or you're type one diabetic and you're low on insulin. So it's better to eat it and just get a more dependable result.
Okay, that was my question. I had an insulin done about a year ago and it was 2. So I know I don't have high insulin.
Ah, okay.
But I am running high blood sugars. So that's why I'm doing this test for myself.
This is an ongoing debate about slightly high. And I know Dr. McCullough was saying the blood sugars went a bit higher, but I think Dr. Westman isn't here. Having a higher blood sugar when you're hypoinsulinemic and healthy may not have near the risk potential as if you're highish blood sugar and you're hyperinsulinemic and in this state. In fact, it may not have any risk at all. And this is going to be a big debate in the coming years.
Who should we follow for that? Sorry to break it.
For
For which?
Who should we follow for that information? And you said it's going to be more prevalent in the years.
Who should you follow?
Besides
me, yeah. The Lower Insulin Facebook group, if you search for that. Marty, Kendall, Optimizing Nutrition. If you really want to go hardcore, Hyperlipid with Peter. Yeah, he's kind of the top. There's probably a few more. We can give. Yeah.
Great talk. So I have been in the wellness industry for a long time and have advised many large companies on cardiovascular risk factor screening. And the tradition has been for 30 years, finger stick, Colostec, you know, LDL, VLDL, yada yada, HDL, blood pressure, BMI, sometimes glucose. And obviously it's measuring most of the wrong things. And so now we've got the CAC test that you're talking about. So the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force, who are kind of the judge and jury of what tests should be widely done for screening in America, has never came out and said CACs are the right things and the most predictive, cost-effective, least harmful, least invasive, no side effects, leading to better results, yada, yada. They're not taking that stance. What's your view of CAC? How much does it cost?
Okay.
How invasive is it? Why is the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force looking at this?
Okay, great question. And probably I'll mention extra details. So it's around $100 in the States at the lower end. It's walk-in. The radiation is a bit more than a mammogram. It's a lot less than a year of background radiation. From what I've studied, I wouldn't care a fig because you only need one and you might check in 7 or 8 years later. In terms of why they don't do it, I think the Widowmaker movie would be great to watch on iTunes or Google Prime because it tells the whole sorry story, but it's seething with politics and interprofessional kind of arguing. There is one last thing I'll just say. The 2013 US guidelines and the 2013 European, for the first time, have recommended CAC for middle risk people. Probably 30 years after they should have done so. It's in the guidelines now, but doctors don't know about it. No one knows about it.
I just want to add
that
the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force just last year endorsed the 2013 guidelines, but not the calcium. It's long forgotten because it really challenges the dogma.
Yeah, there are many challenges with calcium because, not least, one of them is I think there was awareness some time ago that it basically junks the LDL hypothesis. So that's one problem. The other problem is hospitals make a huge amount of money in the CAT lab. And there was a study done, and I think it was Mayo, a clinic, where a team looked and said, wow, with this CAC stats, if we use CAC, non-invasive, really cheap, we can recategorize 50% of our people who have to go to CAT lab and not need to do them. And the hospital looked and said, that's enough, thank you. That's 30% of their revenue, and you've halved it. No way, no way. There you are. Money makes the world go round.
Hey, so I wanted to give a quick plug for the heart calcium score. I've had two in the last 10 years.
Yeah, Jimmy.
One early on when I first started low carb and lost all my weight, and then one like in the past 3 years. And they were both zero.
Yeah.
Which, you know, your 15-year kind of guarantee, you know, it kind of gives me hope. But then you have all these kind of out of whack LDLP, which we've talked about, being very high. Of course, total cholesterol for me has been very high. And so it seems to me that until we get some measurable way of like tracking this insulin resistance that could potentially lead to plaque formation, which would then become heart disease, until you have that really solid, codified, this is what you need to test and this is what you're looking for, I think people are just going to still be left wondering, what's my cholesterol and how's that impacting my heart disease? So how close do you think we are to having an at-home insulin test where we can have these tests done and know how we're doing in that and or other tests that maybe we haven't thought about?
Yeah, it's a good question. The problem is insulin is a radioimmunoassay, and it's just a very small molecule and very difficult. I think it's going to be quite some time before there's like a blood glucose meter for insulin, because there's a different field. However, you can get insulin tests with Meridian Valley Labs in the West Coast, mail order. And you can do the pinprick and do a full craft test with drops of blood on a panel and send it back to them. So it's a little delay, but you can get that. And I don't think it's that expensive.
How much is that?
I'm taking a wild guess here. I know people told me they did it. 150 maybe, or 180, I'm guessing.
So then one more thing on the heart calcium score. Make sure you get the right one, because the right one should be about 100-ish. Some people, I know Dr. Nally, my Thursday co-host, says it's about $500 in Arizona. I get mine for $99 in South Carolina. But if you get one that's $700 to like $1,200, that's the wrong one. Shooting you with dye, you don't want that one.
You do not want a contrast angiogram,
right?
No way. And there's a lot of mix-up. Even people in the field get confused. Coronary angiogram with contrast dye, no way. That's invasive. This is a coronary scan for a calcium score. That's it, CAC score. And it should be around 100 or 150.
It's about 2 minutes inside of the machine.
Oh, yeah.
I did a YouTube video of my wife, Christine, going through it. If you want to go look it up on YouTube, our calcium score, and my name, and you'll find it. But thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Jimmy.